life to protect the environment. We're just very, very pleased to have him here. Couple of housekeeping things, there's restrooms down the hall. Make sure you get your free copy of the Yes magazine, it's available. It's the environmental issue, it's really a good one. Also, paperbacks galore, brought a couple of David's books, his new one, Change the Story, Change the Future, and then the, I think it's the 20th anniversary of When Corporations Rule the World, that redraft is out, and it's going to be great too. Another very small thing, we're really pleased with LCC to allow us to be in this gorgeous space. There is the rent to pay, so if anybody wants to donate for a free will offering to help us out, that would be great. This is our Interfaith Advocates for Justice little group that we put together, and we're pleased to bring David Corton. I'm going to have an introduction through the DVD. I think that's going to be the best way to get in.
And we're going to do, let Fran do the sign-ups.
Yes. Oh, yes. The sign-ups. Yes.
Are you doing that?
Yeah. That'd be great.
So I'm going to pass around. I'm Fran Corton. I'm Dave's wife, and I'm also the publisher of Yes Magazine. And I'm going to pass around sign-up sheets. The options are Dave Corton's newsletter updates some of his writing and thinking very infrequently, maybe a couple times a year. And there's also the option of the Yes Magazine's news roundup every week. So that's a lift to your spirits every Friday afternoon. I highly recommend. So I'm going to pass these out, and I'll do them by these sections. So just keep the clipboard in your section. Okay, thanks.
I'm going to turn off the lights so that we can view the DVD a little bit better. My name is Louis Lapierre, by the way. I teach biology and environmental science here at the college. Very happy to have Mr. Corton here. Yes. Let's see.
David Corton is back home, living in the state of Washington after spending much of his adult life overseas.
Well, I was born in 1937, toward the tail end of the Depression in Longview, Washington, which is a town of about 20,000 to 25,000 people in southwest Washington.
Corton was the first of his family to attend college, primarily because he was supposed to take over the family business.
I was a very conservative young Republican at that time at Stanford. Eventually came to the conclusion, well, I should go ahead and go to business school, learn the secrets of U.S. business success, and then I can participate in sharing those with the rest of the world so everybody else can become happy consumers like us and forget this revolution nonsense.
Then Corton, child of the Cold War era, decided to check out one particular class at Stanford University.
I came across this little course on modern revolution, and I thought, well, as long as I got to take something that's not really relevant to my future, maybe I ought to take that and understand what these revolutions are about. And in that course, I learned that the revolutions were really born of the frustrations of poverty, which is also something that was totally foreign to my experience. And in the course of that, I had this kind of epiphany that I want to devote my life to dealing with that issue.
Corton and his wife Fran lived overseas for the better part of 30 years, doing everything from running business schools to managing U.S. government aid programs. He eventually decided that the best he could do to benefit people in developing countries was to leave, return home, and write a book called When Corporations Rule the World, a Scathing Indictment of Globalization.
Once you begin to look at large global corporations, you see this is kind of the ultimate concentration of institutional power without accountability. My work centered on the whole idea of trying to communicate a deeper understanding of the real implications of the processes.
So tell me about that French proverb about holding the wine in your hand.
hand while you're...
Supposedly, one of life's greatest pleasures is to drink wine in the vineyard from which it comes.
Oh, I love that. I love that.
David Corden advocates local control of agriculture by supporting family farmers as opposed to agribusiness everywhere in the world. Corden is also a very influential author whose most recent book, The Great Turning, envisions a new model for the global community.
That if we continue on our current path, we're all going to suffer the consequences. You know, as the environmental systems collapse, nobody is going to escape that. You know, a lot of people say, I don't understand sustainability, which means, of course, they don't understand the larger system dynamic. To me, it's about bringing ourselves into balance with one another and with the earth. You know, partly it's recognizing that ultimately, you know, the living systems of the earth are the source of all real wealth. If we don't have those living systems, there's no life, we don't exist, and the whole concept of wealth loses any meaning. And it's a very complicated issue. I've been following the specific negotiations, but...
When we visited last summer near his home on Puget Sound, Corden admitted to me that he's not totally optimistic about the future. And yet, giving up, he says, is not an option.
Which is part of this. Realistically, I think we may be finished. But I also realize that as a practical matter, we absolutely have to move forward on the assumption that we still have time and that it is within our capacity. And if we were to assume we have no time, we create a self-fulfilling prophecy. So my conclusion is we have to assume we have time and devote our every ounce of energy to making the turning happen.
So just go ahead. Thank you. It is truly wonderful to be back in Longview after all these years. I understand this may be all the progressives in Longview here. Not at all. Good. So many more. Anyhow, delighted to be with you. The video you just watched was from a few years back. When I spoke at the Wall Street Trinity Church at a national faith conference, that's the church that stands right at the head of the Wall Street, looking down on all the Wall Street establishments. And I actually wrote a book specifically for that event called Agenda for a New Economy, From Phantom Wealth to Real Wealth. It was right after the 2008 crash. And the theme of the book was, Wall Street produces nothing of any value, provides no service that's not provided in better ways, so it makes sense to shut down Wall Street. So you can imagine, there's no greater thrill in my life than standing in the pulpit of that historic church, bring down Wall Street! Anyhow, this will be a little more informal gathering. I also feel a special attachment to this particular institution, which my grandmother, who was rather ahead of her time for a woman, was one of the founders and a member of the Board of Trustees, and she was a huge influence in my life. Part of my early education, and you know, there was a suspicion in our family that she was a closet Democrat, but we didn't talk about that. Anyhow, you got a bit of the story of my life from that video. It was the intention. I was the eldest son that I would come back and take over the family business. I grew up as many of us did, in kind of isolation. I mean, this is, Longview's a very ideal
idyllic sort of part of the world. We also, as you've probably noticed, and as is evident in this room, we were not exactly a racially mixed or culturally mixed community. Still perhaps not. It was quite, you know, growing up as I did in this town, it was impossible to imagine the life that I was going to end up with, living all over the world. Fran and I lived in Africa and Ethiopia. We set up a business school there. I was a Harvard Business School advisor to the Central American Management Institute in Nicaragua. And we lived 15 years in Southeast Asia, in Philippines and Indonesia. And I worked all over Asia with AID and the Ford Foundation. So the move from growing up in a very homogeneous culture to going out into the world and truly experiencing the extraordinary variety of the world's peoples and cultures. And one of the things that is very much an awakening from that kind of experience is you begin to realize how foundational culture is to how we think and how we act and how we organize. It turns out that, you know, that's one of our characteristics as a human. You know, as mammals, evolutionary products, we're partly creatures of our genetic material, but part of what's being distinctive about human is the enormous range of possibilities created by our culture, by our stories. That when we talk about what is our human nature, we in many ways, in very real sense, choose our nature by the stories by which we choose to live. And those stories are essential because we have so many possibilities. The only way we can truly live together is by having something of a shared story. Now, as you may have noticed, in the United States, we've got quite a multiplicity of stories, and they make it very difficult for us to get together in any kind of a coherent frame. So part of my current understanding and current focus, and certainly the focus of this book, Change the Story, Change the Future, is the importance of recognizing our stories and recognizing their impact on our behavior and how we organize as a society. And recognizing that if we get our stories right, if we get them right, we have a most incredible creative potential to live creatively in community, exploring the depths of life's possibilities. But we also, if we get our story wrong, the consequences can be truly devastating. And that's the situation that we're in right now. We've got our story terribly wrong. Now, not only did I come to recognize the importance of stories by living abroad, I also, over time, Fran and I observed over the 30 years we worked in international development, 21 of them actually living outside the United States, that whereas we had gone abroad with this vision of, you know, the United States is sort of the pinnacle of success, of development, of accomplishment, and that, let's call it what it is, the white man's burden, the American's burden to go out and share this with the rest of the world so they could become more like us. And over time, what we realized was that, yes, a few people were getting extremely rich. We were seeing the development of a new middle class, relatively small, but that most people were living in ever more desperate circumstances. You know, it's the most extraordinary thing in terms of the distortions of what passes for economic science and economic wisdom. Is realizing that you take people who may have been in intact communities, living a subsistence life off of the land. But they had strong families, they had strong communities, they were very good farmers, they sometimes had very sophisticated technologies. Fran worked a lot in irrigation in the Philippines and Indonesia, some of the most incredible engineering feats of agriculture and irrigation. These were people who had no money, but were in many ways extraordinarily rich. But in the development process, forcing them off of the land, forcing him into lives with as landless agricultural workers, or into sweatshops. And the economist says, look, we're ending poverty. They're now making a dollar a day. I have a suspicion those economists never tried to live on a dollar a day. And so you begin to realize that life is about more than money. You also begin to realize that what we think of as economic progress and the institutions by which we organize our economy are not necessarily about improving people's lives. And what we realized was that much of what we tout as development and development progress is actually a process of recolonization, but under a system of corporate rule. I'll note, by the way, I was amused this morning. I was reading back over the Daily News article about this upcoming presentation, and I hadn't noticed before, but it referred to my 1995 When Corporations Rule the World as my novel. I suspected a little editorial comment there. Anyhow, I suspect that many of you have had a similar experience to mine. I mean, this is those of my generation. I'm 77. I grew up here in Longview. Of course, I was born in 1937. Grew up here in the 40s and 50s. And then had, you know, at that point, we're going through this transition of opening up to the world. And when I grew up here, I actually could never imagine that I was ever going out of the United States. I mean, just how, it's kind of part of the context. I'd be interested if any of you had that same experience. But in high school, we had to make a choice between studying Spanish and Latin. Well, I couldn't imagine why in the world I would ever need Spanish. That would only be useful if I went outside of the United States. And since everything is here, why in the world would I ever want to go outside of the United States? So I took Latin because somebody said that would be useful in college. And of course, I ended up living a number of years in Latin America where that Spanish would have come in short of hand. But I'm wondering, in terms of hands, how many of you here grew up with a kind of a similar sense of, man, this is it, this is where I am? And then how many of you ended up with some, you know, fairly extraordinary cross-cultural experience, internationally, Peace Corps, any of those things? Yeah. You know, I have a very strong suspicion that out of our generation, one could almost lay out the political divisions between those who got out into a deep intercultural experience and those who did not. And I'll not say more about that right now. But anyhow, the new edition of When Corporations Rule the World, it is a 20th anniversary edition. When this first came out in 1995, people looked at it, what's he mean when corporations rule the world? Is he saying they do rule the world, or maybe they're going to rule the world, or what will happen if they do rule the world? And so that was part of the genius of the title. People had to pick it up to but I don't find anybody asking that question anymore. It's absolutely clear. And the reason we reissued it, the analysis, the core of the book is the same as the original, sort of cleaned up and a little easier to read. But it's essentially the same analysis, because as if I've gone back over it, it is absolutely as accurate in terms of the basic framework of understanding the structures of corporate rule, the institutions, how it connects in with the financial markets. And the ways in which that creates a system that is tied to a focus on short-term financial returns, and then that system controlling these massive monopolistic corporations that are monopolizing ever more of the means of living around the world to hold us in a condition of servitude. Virtually no change in the underlying analysis. It's just far worse now. So the new chapters that I've added update the consolidation of corporate rule, and but they also bring in that over that last that most recent 20 years, we of course have had a very significant development of resistance movements. And also the local economies movements, the back to the youth back to the farm, the farmers markets, the shop local, and all of those elements of rebuilding local economies based on local ownership and the use of local resources and employment of local labor. And of course, right now we're having this extraordinary situation. This. You know, some of you may have noticed in the national politics that President Obama is suddenly now hand in glove with the right-wing Republican corporatists around Fast Track, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which are basically global corporate rights agreements that put corporations ever further beyond the reach of any democratic accountability, that subordinate our legal system to international tribunals. And of course, both our Washington State senators are lined up with the corporatists against democracy, workers, and the environment, which I find very troubling. I gather Senator Murray is in town right here today, raising money. Fran and I have been to her fundraising in the past. I was tempted to go demonstrate this time. Anyhow, let me back at Longview with so many friends. A little carried away here, but I'll get back to it. I'm going to take you on a deep journey on our stories, the story frame, and the implications they have for our lives. The issues are, in many ways, very complex. At another level, they are very simple. They are very straightforward. And I've had the good fortune of, you know, being able to step back and reflect and share ideas with people and try to boil them down to the most basics. So as you listen to some of this deeper analysis, recognize I'm not going to tell you anything that you don't already know. But what I'm going to tell you is so contrary to what we are told every day. And this is part of the extraordinary aspect of coming to recognize the power of our stories. The deepest lessons, I mean, here's the deepest underlying lesson, the takeaway is, we are living beings. We humans are living beings, born of and nurtured by a living earth, itself born of a living universe. And that changes everything. The core of it is indigenous wisdom, the recognition that we are born of an earth mother, a living earth mother. A living being that self-organizes to create and maintain the conditions essential to life. A fundamental truth that we seem intent on denying or forgetting in most everything we do. I became really aware of the power of our deepest messages back in 1999. This was just before the WTO demonstration. Any of you remember the WTO demonstration in Seattle. I spoke at a gathering of the faith community in Seattle, and was on spoke along with Marcus Borg. Any of you familiar with Marcus Borg's work? A very well-known theologian, styled himself a Jesus scholar. Marcus had a defining statement that, you know, one of these statements drills into your consciousness. Tell me your image of God, and I will tell you your politics. Tell me your image of God, and I will tell you your politics. Now, maybe you've already sorted this out. Two images of God in the Christian Bible. One is the distant patriarch. The other is the integral spirit. So one is about the God out there, the external intelligence, which sets up a hierarchy of righteousness and domination. The question of who is closest to God, who is God's most favored. This was very explicit in Calvinism. It is a story of empire. And you go back in history, over 5,000 years of humans organizing in dominator hierarchy, and we have this, there's kind of a characteristic pattern that we evolved gods that were male and in the sky. We forgot our Earth Mother, the process of separation. The spirit image of God is that what we, the divine that we refer to of God is immanent in all being. That all that is manifestation of the spirit of God. That creates a wholly different frame that recognizes that we are all related. That all of creation is related. It is a foundational framework for deeply democratic governance. So this is just one sort of entry point into this deeper question. Now, I do believe that we are in the midst of a very powerful human awakening. We are, I think, getting a breakthrough recognition that we are in deep, deep trouble. And I think we are also getting a recognition that the framing stories by which we organize are partial and out of date and need to be re-examined. And this is why I understand there are many leaders from the local religious community here. One of our deepest needs, one of our deepest failings, is that we have no institutional spaces in our modern society that are devoted to examining our deepest stories and updating those stories, helping us recognize the implications of those stories. And this is an obvious charge or task for our faith institutions to take on. But of course, it's also an essential thing for our educational institutions to take on. I have a sense that our churches may be more receptive and ready than our educational institutions, which are so siloed and also themselves stuck in outdated stories. We come down to two fundamental issues. What will be our defining value? It's very straightforward. Which do we value more, life or money? You remember that Bible verse about no one can serve two masters? I mean, it's essentially, we cannot serve both life and money. God and mammon. We make God a spirit, mammon's money, the worship of money. I love this Pope Francis. particularly his homily, about the idolatry of money. It's not that money is evil. It's actually a very useful institution. But the worship of money is evil. And we've become a society of money worshipers. The way that this drills in for me, very powerful. In March 2012, this was just before the Rio Plus 20 Earth Conference, Rio de Janeiro, the 20th anniversary of the 1992 Earth Summit. And I was privileged to be invited to join a retreat with international environmental leaders, indigenous environmental leaders from around the world who were going to Rio with their message. They noted that the Wall Street interests were going down there and they were saying, yes, we must protect nature. Absolutely. To protect nature, we must value her. We must put a price on her to value her. These indigenous leaders turned out to be a lot smarter than many of us. They recognized, oh, here's a pattern, okay. You put a price, you commodify, you privatize, you securitize. These guys are all eager to set up a new foundation for some new derivatives they can play financial games with and so forth. And they're saying, we need a different frame. We believe that Earth is our sacred mother, that our health and well-being absolutely depends on her health and well-being. Well, that's actually kind of obvious, isn't it? Nothing esoteric here. I mean, these are not things you need a PhD to understand. And that puts you in the frame that if that's true, no matter how much money we can make from harming our Earth Mother, it is not economic in the real sense, in the living sense. So, one of the members of this group was Karmath Sateen, who is the head of the Bhutan Gross National Happiness Commission. I'm sure you've all heard of Bhutan and Gross National Happiness. Probably the best set of indicators, the most sound foundation for really thinking about development that we have. And he gave us a little short presentation on Bhutan and what they're doing there. And he ended with three words. Time is life. Time is life. Well, as you know, my daddy was a businessman at a store. He always taught me that if you're in business, unless you're in business to serve the community, you have no business being in business. And I think that's a great motto. Truly respect and admire him for that. But he also taught me time is money. Yeah, then I went to business school. Have any of you been to business school? You know, everything in the curriculum is essentially built around time is money, the basis for making decisions. That's kind of interesting, you think about that. Time is money or time is life? Did you have a good day today? Did you make a killing? Or did you make a living? And then you think about living in the deepest sense. Yes, we must make our living, grow our food, meet our daily needs. To do that, we must labor. But if we do it the right way, we do it in a way that makes a living. And that brings to mind one of my first ventures overseas, which was a trip to Indonesia back in 1961, before it was much disrupted. I took this incredible train ride through the countryside and saw the people working in the fields, the most extraordinary blending with nature, these terraced rice fields. Humans one with nature. people working in the fields, as they have done through cycles of generations, but close to the land, working in community, working together as a community, creating and maintaining the conditions essential for the life of all. That's making a living. So, I know of no six words to capture more fully the choice that we make. As a society, obviously there's some type of choice of individuals, but it's also society. Time is life, or time is money. Now, part of this, you know, in our Western society, a very individualistic society, we're often taught, well, if, you know, make your choice. If you want to be an environmentalist, be responsible, take care of nature, get rid of your car. It's your choice. Well, the truth is, we make an awful lot of decisions as a society. Fran and I lived in New York City for a time, in the heart of Manhattan. Talk about cars. You've got to be an idiot to have a car in New York City. There are probably not very many places in Longview, Washington, where you can get along without a car, without significant hardship. Because a society does not organize to make that easy to do. So should you have a guilt trip about, I have a car? Or do we focus on, okay, this is one of the changes that we need to make over time in our choices as a community. We ultimately need to reorganize the way we live so that it is very easy to live without a car. This is kind of the forefront of urban planning and thinking. Now, not easy, but it's reflective of the depth of the challenges we face. Now, if you think about the way our economy is organized, I was just thinking this morning of a simple way to put this. We currently have 7 billion people in the world. We also know that as a species, we are consuming at the rate of 1.5 planets, 1.5 planet Earths. That's, you know, in a sense, that's the amount of consumption that we humans, the burden we humans put on the generative surfaces of Earth, services of Earth. Its ability to regenerate soils, to regenerate the soil, to maintain the climate, to absorb our waste, to do all the things that our Earth Mother does to create and maintain the conditions essential to our life. So, 7 billion people consuming a rate of 1.5 planets, we're going to have to do some reduction of our consumption. But then we think, okay, what's our economy doing? Well, currently our economy, which is all geared to growth, growing GDP, and, the statistics are telling us that since the 2008 crash, all of the benefits, all of the gains of economic growth have gone to the top 10% in the United States. Most all of that has gone to the richest 1% in the United States. It's, of course, even more imbalanced globally. And the economy is geared to encouraging those of us who happen to be at a level where we're able to consume more. It's all about getting us to consume even more to grow the economy, to make even more money for the 1%. It gives you a sense of the depth and extent of the problem that we face. Now, why do we get so caught up in this? Why can't we sort out the obvious? It relates to a story. It's a story that has been fabricated. I was just at a conference birds. Any of you listen to Tom Hartman on the radio show? It was just a Unitarian Universalist conference, the annual conference down in Portland. And I ended up filling in for Tom, who had a medical emergency and couldn't get there. So I was going about studying his most recent book, and which lays out, it's the crash of 2016. And it lays out what we know, that back in 1971-72, Lewis Powell, who was a lawyer, wrote a memo to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, laying out how the economic royalists, the economic elite in this country, were losing power to the hippies and flower children and so forth, and that they really needed to get control, and laid out a plan for taking control of the media, taking control of the legal system, taking control of economics education and education more broadly, all to reassert the control and rule of the economic royals. Now, part of that was crafting a story, which we call the sacred markets, the sacred money and markets story. A story fabricated and promoted by corporate interests. Now, part of our education is to become attuned to these stories so we recognize them. So I'm going to listen to each of the elements of the story and think in your mind, have I heard that before? And is it true or is it false? Time is money. Money is wealth. Making money creates wealth, and it is the defining purpose of people, of business, and the economy. Maximizing returns to money maximizes wealth and the prosperity of all. The rich are society's wealth creators. Affluent lifestyles are their fair and just reward. Material consumption drives prosperity and is the path to happiness. Poverty is the consequence of laziness. I see some of you nodding. I suspect you've heard these lines before. Poverty is a consequence of laziness. The earth belongs to us. It is our human nature. It is our human nature to be individualistic, competitive, and acquisitive. These beneficial traits are guided by the invisible hand of the free market to unleash the creative potential of humanity, to grow the economy, to create wealth, end poverty, and drive the technological innovation required to eliminate our human dependence on nature. The community interest is simply an aggregation of the individual private interests of its individual members. We therefore all do best when we each focus on maximizing our individual private interest and leave the governance of society up to corporations. Corporations, after all, are just groups of people working in common cause for freedom, democracy, and mutual prosperity. They're entitled to fair treatment and the same rights as any person. So I assume most of you have heard elements of this story before. And I assume you also recognize that every element of that story is either patently false or grossly misleading. But it is the story around which we organize as a society. So should it be any surprise that we are in deep trouble? Now, why would we accept this story? Well, partly we don't have any regular access to a different story, a more valid story. But I also suggest that it takes us back to our deepest cosmologies. Remember the Marcus Borg story about patriarch or the integral spirit. In Western society, we have three basic cosmologies. These are our deepest stories about the nature of reality, about who are we really, where do we come from. We have very many variations on this. Each of us struggles with that question, I'm sure. I mean, it's part of being human, of who am I? This incredible thing around me, where does it come from? How did it happen? Does it have any meaning, purpose? What drives it? What does it mean? The three basic stories. One is the distant patriarch story that I already mentioned. That's the story of the Abrahamic religions, among others. Then there's the grand machine story of Newtonian science. It's all a grand machine winding down. And then the mystical unity story, which we tend to associate with Buddhism. It's the idea of the only true reality is the mystical consciousness, the mystical spirit, that we are separated from that spirit by our ego, which creates the illusion of separation and is the source of our suffering. So, you look at the implications of each one. The distant patriarch story, in its most conventional telling, look at each of the stories in terms of agency. Where does initiative, control, guidance come from? Relationships. What are the most important relationships in my life? And meaning. What's the source of meaning? Why am I here? What's it about? So, with the distant patriarch, basically, agency is there. God is all-knowing and all-powerful. So whatever is by His will. My most important relationship, then, is my individual relationship with Him. Meaning is figuring out what He wants through His books, through His teachers, or whatever, so that I can get on His good side to get a good place in the afterlife. The focus is on the afterlife, and it's a one-on-one relationship. In the grand machine story, the whole of creation is like a giant clock winding down to a heat death as its spring unwinds. That's interesting. There is no agency, at least not since the creation. Everything's related, but it's like gears in a clock. And meaning? There's no meaning. It just happens. Life is nothing more than the accidental outcome of material complexity. Consciousness is delusion. Wow. That means I am totally alone in a meaningless universe. That's depressing. I think I'll go shopping. Great marketing message. Okay, then we got the mystical unity story. It's all one, it's all illusion. So there's no agency, there's no origin, there's no motive force. Everything's related, but it's not really related, it's just one. There's only one, there's no relationship. And meaning, well, I don't know, it just is. Now you think about this, there is nothing in any of these stories that give us a real frame for thinking about how we live. Can be a real sense of meaning and purpose to the unfolding of creation, which is, as science describes it, quite the contrary to a clock winding down. The arrow of creation is toward ever greater complexity. Beauty, awareness, and possibility. Wow. It's an incredible creative journey. And here's how I think about it. It began with the spirit. Whatever that energy is, whatever that mystical wonder so far beyond our human understanding. But I sense we do reflect some of the energy, power, and drive of that spirit in our own desire to know ourselves, our own desire to create, to contribute. So, in the desire to know itself, the spirit burst forth in this incredible cloud of energy particles that science describes. And then as we understand it, those energy particles join together to form more complex particles and atoms, and then they formed into molecules, and more complex molecules, and they formed into these giant stars, these massive sources of energy that further transform to create more complex forms of matter. And then somewhere along the line, these suns begin to cast off planets, and eventually on one of these planets, this thing we call carbon-based life got established. And in the earliest stages of evolution, as we know, we know very little of how, those very simplest of cells, of organisms, working as a community in conjunction with the geological forces of Earth, transform the surface conditions of this planet to create conditions of atmosphere, soils, water, ocean systems, and so forth, unlike any other planet of which we have any knowledge. All of which are necessary to support more complex forms of life, like, say, humans. And part of this process was extracting excess carbons and toxins from the surface of the planet, sequestering them deep underground as part of creating these conditions. Wow, that's pretty miraculous. You sense where I'm going? We organize our economy around using our most advanced technologies to extract these carbons and toxins from deep underground, maybe like taking coal out of Montana and shipping it out of a port in Longview, Washington. And why do we do that? So we can suppress, control the various forces of nature that maintain the conditions essential to our existence. And we do that so we can make money, which is nothing but a number on a computer hard drive, for people who already have far more money than they have any use of. And we call ourselves an intelligent species. Anyhow, this is a sense of how far out of line we are. It's a consequence of our stories. Now, if we take this living universe story, the story I've just been outlining, and we recognize that we are part of a creative process, that every element of creation is both a product of that process and a contributor to it. It gives us a way of thinking about our role as a human species, as a creative contributor to this dynamic unfolding process. It says, we are part of Earth. We belong to Earth. We are part of an emerging, evolving, creating Earth community, exploring its possibilities toward ever greater beauty, awareness, and possibility. We just need to get our story. Now, if we take that story and translate it into an operational story, a new story for a new economy, I call it the Sacred Life and Living Earth Story. Time is life. Real wealth is living wealth. Money is just a number. It is useful as a medium of exchange in well-regulated markets. We humans are living beings. born of and nurtured by living earth, itself born of a living universe. This is absolutely key for knowledge of biology. Life exists only in community. If you understand the very physics of life, it can only exist in community. Communities continuously organizing to maintain, create and maintain the conditions of its own existence. Earth does not belong to us. We belong to Earth. Earth, a living superorganism that self-organizes to maintain the conditions essential to the existence of all life. Our health and well-being depend on her health and well-being. Our human nature calls us to care and share for the benefit of all. Serving the living community that sustains us is essential to community health, and it is the source of our greatest happiness. When do you experience your greatest happiness? When you've just made a killing, or when you have made a contribution to your neighbor, to your child, to your community? That is our nature. Individualistic greed, ruthless competition, violence against life. These are indicators of serious psychological and social dysfunction. The characteristics that conventional economics identifies as the human ideal and our natural nature are actually the characteristics of the psychopath. Poverty is most often the consequence of a lack of opportunity, and our economy is doing an extraordinarily good job at the moment of stripping away opportunities for ever more of the population. And of course, one of the greatest of tragedies are young people graduating from university with a lifetime of debt. A fundamental principle. The purpose of any human institution, whether business, government, or civil society, is to support people as productive, contributing, sharing members of a vibrant and prosperous living earth community. Corporations are not engines of wealth creation, they are engines of wealth concentration that undermine democracy and essential market feedback mechanisms. In other words, the way they function currently, they are the enemy of both democracy and markets. And corporations that seek to monopolize resources in the pursuit of purely financial ends have no place in a healthy human society. So we've got a lot of work to do. We have to create economies that actually work with the living forces of Earth, of nature. And transforming every aspect of how we live, how we relate to Earth, how we grow our food, how we manage our water, how we build our physical structures of our physical habitat. Now, the magnitude is so great, it can be a little depressing, but think of it as the creative opportunity in our midst to fundamentally rethink and transform ourselves around a new vision of human possibility, grounded in a new understanding of our story, of the nature of our being. It starts with a new story, and to me, the frame of a living Earth, a living Earth community, is absolutely foundational. If you take away one nugget, that is the nugget. But we must examine this story, we must build this new story, we must share it. I truly believe it lives in the human heart, and that most humans that have not been seriously damaged in one way or another by the experience of the dysfunctions of our culture can get it very quickly. You don't even have to preach it, all we need to do is acknowledge it. But then we have to go forward. We've got to create a fundamentally new economics. There is a movement within economics called ecological economics that starts with the frame that, you know, instead of starting with financial flows and markets and derivatives and all that, you start with life. You start with Earth, with the ecological processes. Dynamics, the living dynamics of living Earth. That's the start. Society is embedded within that. the economy is a subsystem of society, is a subsystem of living Earth. That leads to a wholly different economics, and there are some of us that are working on that challenge. Then you come to law, and you recognize that in our current law, corporations literally have more rights than persons. Partly it's our Supreme Court and its distortions. Partly it's international agreements like NAFTA and the agreements that now President Obama is trying to lay on us, the Trans-Pacific Partnership and so forth. But it also is a carryover that many aspects of our law and property rights and so forth are, you know, I'm beginning to realize that they're sort of a, you know, they're more derivative of the law underlying the divine right of kings. And part of the, you know, the way the king ruled was controlling access to land, deciding who had land. Our whole set of property rights needs to be rethought in the most fundamental way. I believe private property is a very good thing. It's such a good thing that everybody should have some. And, you know, we come to recognize that economic democracy, participation, real participation in ownership, is essential to political democracy. Because in the end, political power is held by the people who own property. And I'm not talking about fictitious communism or socialism, I'm talking about, you know, things like cooperatives or small businesses or small farms and people owning their own homes and real ownership. So that's another element is the ownership, how ownership is distributed in society. So a lot of work to do here, a lot of creative challenge and possibility. And I've spoken actually longer than I intended. I got so excited by this group. I love you guys. Anyhow, let's throw it open and have a conversation for...
I have a question.
Yeah.
Up here. I was just wondering if you make your email available to communicate with others.
Yeah. She wants to know if I would make my email available so people can communicate with me. As you can imagine, I as much as I'd like to, if we're going to have any individual conversations, we need to do it here.
Okay. Can you comment on your website, www.communicatecommunities.org?
I don't really have a...
I thought there's some kind of way, because Kat is always giving you messages from your website.
Well, yeah.
I think you've left out one important power in your speech completely.